genre.
Welcome back to Rocky Minute, the daily podcast that analyzes the movie Rocky 1 minute at a time. I am Doug Greenberg.
And I'm Jason Haynes.
And one final time joining us from sunny LA is Sully from Sully Baseball. How you doing, Sully?
I'm talking Rocky. I'm doing well.
Awesome. Thank you for joining us all week long. Yeah. I know you're busy, and we appreciate you taking the time out to hook us up.
I'm never too busy to talk Rocky.
All right. Well, today we're knocking out minute 15, which starts with Rocky handing Mr. Gazzo Bob's contribution and ends with Gazzo asking Rocky why he didn't break poor Bob's thumbs. So we got the Cadillac drives away in that last scene from minute 14. And Rocky gives Gazzo Bob's $130 and speculates that Bob will be good for the rest next week. He's putting an awful lot of confidence in Bob here.
He says it kind of like nonchalant, like, guys, like, yeah, Bob's good for it. Like, it's almost like he didn't care.
Right.
About the money.
We find out he cares more about his reputation than the money.
Right,
anyway.
Sure.
Yeah. This was, this Gazzo, who appears in, I know he's in the second Rocky film. I don't think, is he in Rocky 3 or not?
I don't think so.
I think by the time Rocky 3 came out, Rocky had transformed from the down and out guy in the streets of Philly to a superhero, and they almost wanted to exorcise any sort of link to him and anything shady. He was America. He was a good American hero, and so I'm sure there are a ton of people who were introduced to Rocky through Rocky III. When that came out the same year as E.T. and Poltergeist, and I think of movies in terms of one the other movies that came out, that and I'm sure with the popularity of Eye of the Tiger, and it basically was a superhero film rather than a 70s drama, I'm sure a lot of people were introduced to him fighting Mr. T and everything and thinking that all the films were like that. And I bet if you were introduced through Rockies 3 and 4 and went back and watched the original, these scenes would be kind of startling. Like, what do you mean Rocky's working with a mobster? I mean, that's not who Rocky is. Rocky's a superhero.
Yeah, superhero. That's exactly what they make him out to be. Mm-hmm. The Rocky movies go from, like you said, drama to action movies. The action movies of the 80s, which that was the style of movies then in the 80s.
And we have to give a big thumbs up to the great the late great Joe Spinell, who plays Gazzo. Yeah. His first role was as Willie Chichi in The Godfather, and he has a much bigger part in Godfather 2. Although he did have that scene where he stops the what's it called, the, when you go through the, what is it, the roundabout, the revolving door. During the baptism scene, they show all the different assassinations.
Right,
and he stops
right,
the poor, I think it was Don Cuneo or whatever it was, in the revolving door. And the guy realizes he can't move, and then he shoots. And there's that really scary shot where you see him shooting the gun at the camera. Real sort of great, you know, bank train robbery style, right at the camera and the glass breaking. And he has a much bigger part in Godfather 2. But him being in the part in the film just sort of subconsciously bringing you back to the Godfather adds a sense, like the appearance of Tally Shire in the film, sort of like, oh, I remember him, even if you can't place him. You know, he has that.
Yeah,
look,
he's one of those.
He has that look and that feel, and it's sort of, this film is Godfather approved, you know. And with that in mind, you know, with the sort of the romanticism of what the mafia is from the Godfather, that's, you know, the guys in the great suit who are basically overseeing empires of this and that. This is probably what a mob boss is really like. He's in the Cadillac. He's dealing with sort of nickel. Whether or not they're going to get 70 extra bucks from a schmuck like Bob. And, you know, it's probably not as glamorous and as romantic as The Godfather. It's probably like this. And it's this simple. It's like, all right, these guys are here. You want my protection. You want to dance. You got to pay the band. And I hire this local boxer to sort of intimidate people. And you know, he puts his glasses on while he's doing the accounting.
Glasses, yeah. Well, when he's writing down the next collection,
right?
But Rocky's cut of this is only $20. So what's that? $60 he made in 2 days. $40 on the fight.
Yeah,
$20 he's doing today. Himself. Yeah, I guess.
You know, I was just reading something here. I was looking up Joe Spinell.
Yeah,
and he was actually born Joseph Spagnuolo. And he's the cousin of the defensive coordinator for the New York Giants, Steve Spagnuolo.
No kidding.
Who knew?
Wow.
That's just weird.
That's quite...
That's
who would have thought, right? But go ahead, back to...
That was the shocking...
just caught my eye. I was like, I saw it, I was like, this can't be the... Yeah, oh my God, it is. Man, what do you can find from Wikipedia nowadays?
I don't know. Well, it must be true.
So go ahead, back to...
Must be true. It's on Wikipedia. Right.
They would never put anything fake on there.
Again, another great location when they pull the car over. I mean, I don't want to get too far ahead here. When they pull the car over, they find, you know, there's so much care put into where they shoot each scene. It's not like, oh, this street corner was available. Let's just shoot here. Let's find a place that where we are helps tell the story. And so look at it. I mean, after they do the scene and you get the license plate of the car that ran over your face, you know, that guy, what a douchebag he is. I mean,
right?
You know, and he's got that, and he's got that, the Fu Manchu mustache. He's got that awful hat. He's got that horrible tie. I mean, if you see that tie, the gold tie with the sort of the striped shirt, it does not go. I am not a fashion plate. But everything is wrong with this guy. This guy got dressed in the dark, and he's got that stupid hat on, this horrible getup, and he's crapping on Rocky? Come on.
But he delivers that joke with such
venom.
Anger behind it. Right. Venom.
You could tell immediately that these two don't like each other.
Do not like each other.
As soon as he says, did you get the last bit of truck? Rocky rips off the glasses. You know, and he just right away, like the look we're looking at his face right now, like he's angry automatically. You can tell there's some tension between these two.
And think of it, we've had two jokes told. One was told to win the heart of a forgotten girl, and the other was to humiliate the hero of the film. I mean, so they're just and both jokes stink. One is endearing, and one makes you say, "What an asshole!"
My note is that Rocky gets a lesson in how to deliver a joke.
But you think, like, you know, these guys work for the same guy. You think they would be getting along, but you could tell there's some tension there. They do not like this.
Well, he has a better job. He gets to drive. He has a tie. He is you know, he's clearly higher on the pecking order. Then Rocky.
Right. Rocky's a collector. He's a chauffeur.
But I don't know, because we're going to find out in a second that, you know, Gazzo wants to talk to Rocky, obviously, about him not breaking the thumbs, we can assume. But he doesn't do it in front of the bodyguard.
I didn't mean to cut you off, man. I think it's because he likes Rocky.
Right.
I think he personally likes Rocky. I think that he has, and that he knows... That one of the reasons why he likes Rocky is that he thinks Rocky's a good guy. He's a nice guy from the neighborhood who just happens to be able to have the physical capability of beating the shit out of people. And this is almost to remind him, I'm not going to humiliate you in front of the douche in there. But I'm going to take a moment aside to remind you that you work for me not because you're a nice guy. You work for me because... You can break people's thumbs, and let's not forget the pecking order. This is a chewing out he gets, but he has enough. He likes Rocky to the point where he knows that he chews him out in front of the driver. It's an unnecessary humiliation.
And maybe that's part of the tension, is maybe, you know, the driver has the better job, he drives him around, but maybe Gazzo likes Rocky better, and the driver has some animosity towards that.
Like, yeah, the driver knows that.
Right, so maybe that's part of the problem here, but they definitely like each other.
All right, so here's the line for those of people that don't know. He asks Rocky, did you get the license plate? Rocky says, of what? Of the truck that run over your face.
That was a good delivery, too.
It's a well-crafted joke.
Yeah.
It's not easy to invent the jokes.
One of the follow-ups to Rocky for Stallone, when he thought his career was going on the De Niro trajectory and not the Stallone. He created a brand new kind of movie star. But the next film he did was the next year called Paradise Alley, which was a period piece about guys involved in mob stuff and con artists and everything. And it was kind of a dark 70s film, which I'm sure he thought he was going to make instead of playing Rocky until he was an octogenarian. And Armand Arsante was in the film, and Joe Spinell is in the film playing a character called Burp. Who knows, maybe it's a wonderful movie. I've never seen Paradise Alley. But Joe Spinell, he's in another Stallone film, along with Tom Waits and Ann Archer. So I don't know. I mean, it was written and directed by Stallone. And that and Fist were both films that he thought he was going to build upon. And then the public said, no, make Rocky too, would you please?
We collectively thank him for that.
And by the way, he's also, Joe Spinell is also in Nighthawks, another Stallone film.
Wow. They worked together a few times.
With Rutger Hauer and Billy Dee Williams. So, yeah, maybe it's one of those situations that, like, he knew, we get along and that works fine,
Yeah. I mean, maybe it's more of just a case of Gazzo Lake and Rocky. Maybe they had a friendship outside the studio.
There's a detail, and you may be getting to this. It's not in this minute. I'm sure you're getting into it when it comes up, so I'm probably stepping on someone else's minute. But there's a detail that when he's having that scene where he chews out Rocky, that he busts out the inhaler.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And that's not in the script.
No.
He really needs the inhaler. And Adelson decided that was a nice thing to do for his character, that it added an element of kind of humanity to him, but also people who use inhalers. This guy might need to have a damn inhaler.
Yeah, it showed the human side of an otherwise, surly guy.
And today, if he busts out an inhaler, you're having a bronchial experience or like that, that leads to a plot point.
Yeah,
no, he just has an inhaler.
No, he's has an inhaler. Having a real asthma attack right there. But it's little nuggets like that. You talked about earlier in the week about the unscripted stuff that they kept in. It works. Yeah. It all works. Del Rio. How do you spell Del Rio? he's wearing those clear frame glasses that are, is it taped together on the side? There's something
on this side.
Yeah, it looks like on his right lens is his arm taped lens, on.
Something's taped up there. Broken glasses.
Yeah, but he busts out a little notepad. He's nearsighted or farsighted. If he needs that to write, he's probably farsighted, right?
Or he's just had his eye punched a lot. Yeah. That could be part of it.
Okay, he's been punch blind. Fair enough.
I'm not an ophthalmologist, but, optometrist. Sorry, I'm not an optometrist, but, maybe getting punched in the face affects your eyesight. I don't know.
That's a little, it's odd to see him throw on a pair of glasses. So is he carrying those glasses in his jacket?
I guess, yeah.
What if they got broken when he was breaking Bob's thumbs? I guess we'll never find out. So you mentioned the street that they pull over. It's East Gurney Street in Philly, which is geographically, it's right around the corner from East Tusculum Street where Rocky's apartment is. I'm not sure if it's meant that way for the movie, but you got that green train bridge in the background when Gazzo's talking to Rocky. You got that cobblestone busted up, like red cobblestone street.
Yeah. And you have the building that's falling apart. You have a building that's basically abandoned and, like, holes in it. I mean, it just looks like, this is a street that we've just forgotten about. This is falling apart, and there's nothing here. The buildings are falling apart. And, they get out, and he sort of adjusts his coat, but it's and they walk over to the trains, and the trains are kind of, everything looks dirty. This is more a little bit of setting up. This is what Philadelphia is at this point. These neighborhoods are falling apart. There's graffiti, there's trains, and it's just, it says a lot about the character of Philadelphia in this movie without hitting you over the head with it.
You notice that as they're walking, there's two little kids that are running along the train tracks playing. I guess that was a thing in Philadelphia in the 70s, you play on the tracks, on the train tracks. They're sounds very hard dangerous. To notice. They go running by.
Yeah, I didn't know it until you just pointed it out right
I
now.
I just saw it for the first time right there, and I watched this minute at least 30 times. Right
well,
now.
We learned...
Well, you notice the other thing about...
I'm sorry. Go. I keep interrupting. Sorry.
I was going to say, you know, we noticed the how he talked about, like, he doesn't want to talk, have this conversation in front of the driver. But look how far away from the car they walk. Like, they could have had this conversation anywhere along this
Yeah, that,
walk.
That is a long
they
walk.
They go pretty far. So it's clear that he really doesn't want his driver to hear this conversation.
We learn in Rocky II that there's a whole population of kids who all they do is run around the city. They don't have parents. They have no supervision. They just run down the street halfway across town and chase Rocky up the steps. You know, so we see that this is clearly maybe with those two kids we see run along the tracks. Eventually, are like, hey, we'll run with Rocky because that's all we're doing all day is run around Philadelphia.
They're just looking for somebody to chase down through yeah. Philadelphia.
There's when I was looking for the name of the B Street Bridge, an article popped up that asked how far did Rocky run in Rocky II?
It's like 5 point.
And it's miles. I think it's even longer than that. I didn't get into it because obviously we're not on Rocky II, so well, I don't care right now.
I think it was 5.9 miles, 5 point something miles.
So those kids ran.
Dude, there's a lot of bullshit. Extra stuff.
The kids ran with him for 6 miles.
Yeah.
Where are we? Gurney Street. Looks just like it did in the movie. Still looks like that today. Except that iron fence is like a chain link fence.
Cobblestone
now.
Street is still in
Cobblestone tax? Street is still there.
Busted up in 1976.
Yeah, still there.
Wow. Wonder what those kids are up to nowadays.
Still running. So Gazzo starts getting into it, asking Rocky why he didn't break the guy's thumbs. That's where the scene ends.
Ugh.
And sadly, our week with Sully.
Yeah, we'll never find out.
We'll never find out. Movie over.
Yeah, strange end to this movie. Yes, it ends with this. Sort of abrupt. I thought there was boxing in it.
There was in the first 5 minutes.
It's over quick.
Yeah. Oh, man. So why don't you tell us, Sully, one last time where we can find you and what you're working on?
I'm doing a bunch of stuff right now. The podcast, I'm getting ready for the postseason. I do my daily baseball card. I'm going to be doing a lot of new episodes of the podcast, and we do at least one new one every week all year round. Christmas, New Year's, we do a show all the time. But basically, if you're a baseball fan, follow me on Twitter at Sully Baseball, and I post everything I do there.
Excellent. I can't thank you enough for joining us this week. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Well, we like to...
Before we go, though, speaking of baseball, I know you had said you were from the New England area, but Aaron Judge just hit the longest home run in the history of Citi Field just now.
Oh, did he?
Really? So are the Yankees winning?
I don't know. My friend just texted me that he just hit the longest home run in Citi Field history. Maybe we can cover that tomorrow on the.
I had Jason Keitel of writer for WFAN on the show earlier this week, and we talked about I am a Red Sox fan, but I am objective enough to know that when something is good happening with the Yankees, that I'll praise it. Mm-hmm. The fact that I've seen them win a few World Series, the Red Sox have won a few World Series, has made me a little more objective than I had in the past. I appeared in a couple of HBO documentaries about the Red Sox. One was called The Curse of the Bambino. The other was called Reverse the Curse of the Bambino. And I was I was a little less giving in my affection for anything Yankee in those documentaries, but but these are two straight days he's homered now. I mean, he was in a big slump after the All-Star, but as I was saying there, he got off to such an amazing first half that it's like, yeah, he's probably going to come to earth a little bit because he's probably not going to win the Triple Crown as a rookie.
Yeah.
You know, yes. So it's like,
I don't think anybody was delusional.
Yeah, I think that he's going to have a wonderful season instead of a, oh my God, historic, better than anything Joe DiMaggio ever did season. You know, it's like, there's a gray area between this is one of the most remarkable seasons in baseball history and you're a bum. There's a big gray area, and some of it could be he's having an exceptional rookie of the year season. And, you know, it's, I think people were panicking because, oh my God, he had a bad 3 weeks. Well, yeah, he had an extraordinary, and he carried the team for the first half of the season. So, he's a good player. He's going to wind up having a very good year, and he's going to win the Rookie of the Year. And I think the Yankees are going to make the postseason. I think the Red Sox are going to make the postseason, and that hasn't happened since 2009 that they're both in it. And nobody's left. No one's left from 03 and 04. So it's like a completely new cast. You know, it's a real Jean-Luc Picard Next Generation going on here. And
the rivalry has simmered down as of late. So it would be nice to kick it back up again.
Kick back up with people from their own farm system. You know, it's like these guys are Yankees, and the guys on the Red Sox, like the Benintendi and the Betts and the Bradleys and the, you know, all these guys, Bogarts, all of them start with B for some reason. but, you know, they're all from their farm system, these guys from the Yankees. So it's like, it's not like they were, you know, going through other teams' bargain bin, you know, like, oh, we'll take, like, the Red Sox and Yankees used to treat the rest of baseball the way that Rodney treated the pro shop in Caddyshack. Like, I'll take that player, I'll take a Gary Sheffield, I'll take a Curt Schilling, I'll take this, and oh, it looks good on you, though. You know, it's like, no wonder, like, no wonder the rest of baseball hated the two franchises because, like, oh, what a surprise! They're choosing between the Red Sox and Yankees. You know, I get it. I know. I understand it. I've lived in California now, and I've seen a lot of people hate on my team. People don't hate on teams that are bad. They hate on teams that are good. I just wanted to say one thing, so the audience doesn't completely hate me. I don't give two shits about the Patriots. Two shits about the Patriots. I would trade every single Patriot, not just Super Bowl, but postseason victory for J.D. Drew to get a double in Game 7 of the 2008 American League Championship Series. All of them. The Tuck game, the big comeback last year against Atlanta, the interception of the goal line against Seattle. Trade them all in for J.D. Drew to get a double right there. Couldn't care less. But in a way, it's great because I get all the positive things about the Patriots. You know, oh, your team won. And when they lose, I said, I don't care. I when they played the Giants in the Super Bowl, I rooted for the Giants.
Wow. You're upsetting a lot of Boston fans right now.
Oh, come on. I've been on HBO talk about the Red Sox, for God's sakes.
Okay. You're forgetting.
I was at the Bloody Sock game as a Red Sox fan, you know. I'm not a football fan. I can't follow a sport that's only on once a week. I just can't do it. It's just like, you know, I can't put all my eggs into that kind of basket. So
a lot of people say the same about baseball because it's too long and boring or whatever.
Well, you know, it's for smart people. You know, if you're like, I only can watch one game week, only one game week. Okay, then fine, then watch football. It's like if you actually want to put some emotion and attention and pay attention to something kind of interesting, then watch baseball. If you want to, you know, write your name with a stick and eat your boogers, then just enjoy a good football game from time to time.
On that note, for those of you that are still with us, why don't you come follow us on our Facebook group, Mighty Mix. You can find us on Twitter at Rocky Minute. And check in on duelinggenre.com, where you can find all the projects that those guys are working so hard to produce. Again, Sully, thank you so much for coming on with us. It was a pleasure.
Let me know when you're doing Rocky 2. I'll be there.
You bet. You'll be the first call we make. All right, man. So if you want to find out how much trouble Rocky is in, you're going to have to come back next week on the next Rocky Minute.